Vikes Now, I am Dustin Baker. It is April 13th, 2 weeks from right now. Alli, welcome to the show. We're going to be hanging out, probably digesting what the pick is or who they traded down with or something like that. But welcome to the show. First time guest. How the hell are you tonight?
I'm doing great. I'm really honored to be here. Thanks.
Oh, absolutely. And in case I forget, what is your Twitter handle? That way the group can follow you.
It's at, what is it? At Alli underscore Elise. I never pay attention to my own Twitter handle.
Double L. That's correct.
Double
right?
L, yeah. Yep.
All right, I don't want to throw anybody off. And you've been a Viking fan your whole life. Is that fair to say?
Since conception, basically. So
that's awesome.
Yes.
And yeah.
So what is my Twitter handle? Oh, at Alli underscore Elise. 25.
Yep. And then if folks find this on Twitter, you'll be tagged in it. So we'll get through it there. And then the draft is a special time for you. You want to explain that to me?
Yes. The draft is always been a special time, especially for me and my dad, because he's the one that, you know, put the hooks in me and got me into the Vikings since day one. And I still remember kind of our tradition was to, back in the day when you know, printed everything, yeah. printed off all of the picks and the player bios, and we had highlighters, and our entire basement was just like covered in like data. And it was just, that was our weird bonding moment, but it still sticks with me. And that's why the draft is always one of my favorite weekends of the year.
He, especially, I don't know how old he would have been, but with a young kid, that sounds like the real deal type of fan who knows his shit. If he's printing out all the, I guess it probably would back then would have been ESPN printouts, and then knows, yeah. Oh yeah, that sounds like the type of guy I'd wanted to get to hang out with.
He is great. I think, you know, in his, I don't want to say older age, cause I know he's going to watch this and then get mad at me. You know, I think he's kind of taken a step back because I've kind of come full force and being so obsessed with it. So he's like, I kind of let you take the emotional baggage and reins from here. So that's kind of where we've ended up, but you know, we're always texting and calling during this weekend. So I'm looking forward to it.
Yes. And once again, it's only 2 weeks away. And because you have since you've taken the scepter from your father and you have a honed interest in the draft right out of the gate, I got about five questions for you. I want you to tell the guys and gals watching tonight or tomorrow, tell three draft crushes that come the first to come to your mind.
Okay. So my first draft crush is Bijan Robinson. Now I was fully expecting to say, you know, bye-bye to Dalvin, go right off in the sunset, wish you all the well. But if we haven't at this point, I don't know if we will. However, if we were in need of a running back and I was basing like all my decisions off just purely looks, he's number one for sure.
Right on.
Number two would be Will Levis, as long as he's not doing that like vote for Pedro mustache thing, mm-hmm. not about that. Because he kind of just reminds me of like the popular guy in high school.
Yeah, who
could be a great guy, like a nice guy, but everybody knows he's just a complete Todd, but that's why everybody likes him. So he's number two. And then bear with me.
Mm-hmm.
Cody Mock from North Dakota State.
Okay.
Because how can you not love a good old boy with missing teeth and knows how to play the fiddle? Like if I was still living in North Dakota, that's worth like three goats and a cow and a dowry. Like that's top notch. So I always have high hopes for my Bison players, but I don't know. I just think Cody kind of has what it takes to make a really long career. He kind of reminds me of Billy Turner, mm-hmm. who was playing at North Dakota State when I was there. And, you know, Billy's had a lot of injuries and such, mm-hmm. but he's had a great long career with numerous teams. And I think Cody's honestly, like in the long run, going to be better. So those are my three crushes.
All right. That's fair. I want to ask you about the Todd that you referenced. Number two, Will Levis. Are you talking about trading up to number 10, number 16 to get him? Or are you talking about if he organically falls at number 23?
Organically. Okay. Like, is that ever going to happen? No. But mm-hmm. those would be like my crushes. And again, this is like more off of like looks than knowledge base.
Yeah. All right. Cool. Well, then let's let's drop the crush convo for a second, and let's talk about honest to goodness predictions. Last year, Kwesi controversially traded back. He could have just drafted Kyle Hamilton, damn it, in number 12, and everything would have been hunky-dory, but he got cute. And we got Lewis Cine out of the deal, Andrew Booth, Brian Asamoah, Ed Ingram. So there's a lot of dudes that have a lot of promise. So kudos to him there. So there's a camp skippered by this guy that thinks that they're probably going to trade down again. But I want to know, regardless, whether you think they trade up, whether they stay put, or they trade down, who do you think will be the first pick, no matter where it is?
I have a lot of thoughts on this.
Let's hear them.
We only have 5 picks, mm-hmm. so I'm not going to be surprised if we tried to trade down, especially I hate not having any second round picks that just like is a pit in my stomach for some reason. But, you know, Kwesi said in just like their recent presser that, how did he put it? Like the fire hose isn't going off as much mm-hmm. as it was last year. So maybe I'm reading too much into it, but that kind of tells me that he's more comfortable with his style and his decision-making skills that maybe he wasn't as confident in because it was his first draft last year. So that being said, I don't know if we're going to trade as much, but I still think we will trade down. There was a couple good points that I heard recently after Odell got signed by the Ravens of like, well, if the Ravens are picking at 22, that's not a bad idea for the Vikings to pick 23, a wide receiver, you know, especially if the Ravens aren't putting priority on drafting a wide receiver anymore, you know, thanks to Odell. But, you know, I know Quentin Johnson is still slated to go to the Ravens. A lot of people have him slated to go to the Vikings, but we have Justin Jefferson. And I think KJ Osborne has definitely proved his worth. And personally, I'd like to see more of like a 2 tight end scheme. So my thoughts of Quentin Johnson are kind of doubtful. I wouldn't be mad, mm-hmm. but I think there's just like bare holes to fill. I heard PA say as recently as today that he believes they're going to take an offensive tackle and, you know, there would be a transition to guard. And, you know, in PA, I trust, obviously, mm-hmm. but how do you not prioritize defense with the abysmal showing that was the 2022 season? I don't know how you don't prioritize defense. So the two names that I kind of keep going back to are 2 corners, because God knows we need those. So Joey Porter Jr. from Penn State, Christian Gonzalez from Oregon. Problem is, you know, I think they're slated a little too high mm-hmm. to realistically be even at 23, you know, especially considering teams like the Patriots, the Bears, Commanders, Colts, they're all in need of a corner. So realistically, you know, if we're going to do corner, maybe Deion Bates is more of a better fit for 23 or later. But my big question, and you can give me your thoughts on this, mm-hmm. is where the hell is Za'Darius Smith?
Yeah.
Is he on the team? Is he not on the team? Like whatever came of that. So honestly, whether he is or not, we're going to need an edge rusher to better fit, you know, Flores' scheme. So if it's an edge, I'm thinking possibly Miles Murphy if he drops, but maybe more of like a Keon White pick.
Okay, so it sounds like when you look up at the screen, whenever Kwesi makes the pick, that you think it will be a defender, correct?
I hope so.
Yeah, would have willed it into existence.
I do. I think that the addition of, you know, Brian Flores, you can't overlook the fact that we're going to have, hopefully, an entirely different, you know, defensive scheme. Mm-hmm. But also, where is our personnel for defense? You know, it feels like we lost half of our team in the offseason just to free agency. We need to replace personnel, and we need young guys on the defense as well.
So on Za'Darius Smith, you are correct. 5 weeks ago today is when he tweeted, "Thank you all, Minnesota, Skull for the vibes, and we'll see you next time." And then, like, within 2 minutes of that tweet, Ian Rappaport retweeted it and says, "The Vikings are not interested in releasing him." So it leads us to believe there would probably be a trade if they're being stubborn about this, because they can really clear some cap space by getting rid of him via release, or perhaps they're waiting until after June 1st. But I think he could probably fetch a fifth rounder, maybe a low fourth. So I'm going to guess that if they don't have a come to Jesus kumbaya, that he would be offloaded during this draft to get a couple more picks back. But in the meantime, they did sign Marcus Davenport for 1 year and 13 mil. And I expect Danielle Hunter to probably get a contract tweak or extension in the next 2 months. So if Zadarius comes back, then all of a sudden you have like the best edge rushing group in the world, because you'd have Danielle, Zadarius, Davenport, Patrick Jones, DJ Wanham. So yeah, you'd be paying a lot for those guys. You'd be paying the most to any edge rushing group in the NFL, but you'd also have the production there. So I think Zadarius, if I had to guess, ultimately is traded, and that's why he wasn't released and we're waiting for this long. And the best spot for that to be would be in the draft, probably to a team like the Ravens, who drafted him, or the 49ers, who always want to get richer on the edges. All right, the next thing I got for you is, now you got to correct me if I'm wrong here. I think in the time that I've known you digitally from afar, I'd venture to say that you are a fan of Kirk Cousins for the most part.
Yes.
And so right now, in my opinion, the biggest aspect of this offseason of free agency, possibly aside from the Brian Flores hire, is the fact that they did not extend Kirk Cousins' contract. Mm-hmm. Now, he's going to be 35, and that's a brand new segment of the Kirk Cousins debate, is we never had to worry about him hitting a wall, or, you know, he's probably peaked. Usually guys, unless their name is Rodgers in 2020 and 21, don't get a whole lot better. They either sustain or decline at age 35. So that is why I think even the reasonable Kirk Cousins fans are like, yeah, it's probably time to start looking at the next guy, because age is coming in. All of that said, he's slated, if they want an exit ramp, it's clear now, 2023 would be his finals year. Are you content with that?
No.
speech.
See, how I feel about the whole Kirk Cousins thing is, like, I am more concerned about talking about Kirk Cousins than I am talking about, like, any political affiliation at this, like, place and time, because that gets more heat than anything. No, I was skeptical of Kirk when they signed him. Obviously, the money is, that conversation's never going to go away. Yeah. And fine, so be it. Mm-hmm. But honestly, I don't see another reasonable option at quarterback that is as reliable as Kirk in the next 2 years. Now, say we do draft a quarterback, that would have to be the ultimate bullseye of a pick, mm-hmm. for that guy to only need 1 year and be starter material. Can it happen? Sure. We've seen it happen plenty of times, just not with this team. So, and as a lifelong Vikings fan, it's like, I don't know if I'm physically and or mentally capable of that much optimism. I want to have it, but that just doesn't seem like a 1 year possibility. Maybe two, but by next season, if Kirk's not our starter, I will have concerns.
So this is probably why, crush aside from the looks or the toddishness, it's probably why you wouldn't mind Levis at 23 so he could marinate for a year. Am I getting that right?
Yeah.
Okay.
And that's with somebody who projected is going to be ready. You know, there's, I think, slim chance, like I said, but, you know, am I going to be mad if one of those top tier quarterbacks does fall? No, I won't.
The thing that you reference Cousins' money, and it always makes me smirk, is his contract is like, it turns
up now.
Yeah. Right now it's exactly like Ryan Tannehill's and Jared Goff's. And I don't know, maybe it's because I'm not ingrained in those fan bases. Nobody cares that Ryan Tannehill or Jared Goff make $35 million a year. I know that they're not elite, and neither is Kirk, but he's pretty damn good. And so I was asked a question earlier today on a show about Ryan Tannehill, and I was like, that's the same contract, Kirk. Nobody cares. It's just for some reason Kirk is flies to honey for debates in general, like you talked about, almost like a political affiliation.
Yeah, and I would rather have Kirk than Goff or Tannehill.
Yeah. Oh, amen to that. We talked about Kwesi's ardor for trading. Wall Street guy, analytics guy, really showed it last year, traded 6 times during the 2022 NFL draft, the most by any human being in those 3 days. You think he pulls the trigger on trades more, less, or the same in 2 weeks?
I don't think it's unreasonable to say that he'll pull off another 6+ trades. I mean, if we've seen him do it once, we can see him do it again. But, you know, because of the limited picks that we have and the number of holes that we need to fill, that's, you know, I don't think that's unreasonable. And that's not even considering the players we lost in free agency. That's just places and people we need to replace. So, you know, I can see it both ways. I mean, we saw the Rams do just fine with them F them picks mentality, yeah. But that was only for a season. And I'm not sure how much capital we really have to make any deals. But I don't know, if I was a betting gal and I had to put money on it, I say he gets 6 done again.
Yeah, I think the easiest way, if you want to call it that, to find the capital is to take the 23, just do what he did last year, flip it down to 30, 31 to the Chiefs or something. And then even take that, if you get real sexy, and then flip that down 4 or 5 spots and then grab another third rounder. So it would be like a domino effect where if you really truly believe that, and your dad might believe this, or his old self, that the 20 through the 100 spot or the sweet spot of this draft, which allegedly is the case, then you could be looking at 4 to 5 picks if you truly believe that that's the section that you want to pursue. So you say it's probably we should expect a reasonable.
I think repeat. So. I don't see this team being comfortable with just 5 picks. And don't get me wrong, it's, you know, that sounds good now, you know, trading back to, you know, 31, 32. And it's easy for me to say, like, I was kind of getting pissy last year with all the trades because I'm having Spielman PTSD flashbacks. Mm-hmm. But, you know, we don't know how these drafts are going to turn out for years. So if I had to make a judgment on last year's draft, you know, not bad, not great, but, you know, we need to see Ingram be better. We need to see a full season from Lewis Cine, you know, but with Duke Shelley, who I'm still really heartbroken, who's gone, Chris Boygan, we need Andrew Booth. We need Caleb Evans. For me personally, they need to have a great season this year for last year's draft to not be a complete bust so far. So I do see us trading because, I don't know, last year's draft I'm still really iffy on. So
2 points of order there in the press conference today that you talked about. Kwesi actually kind of played it cool when they asked him about trading. He's like, oh, I'm just looking for the best impact, as if, you know, as if he doesn't have a resume of all these trades. And then he said exactly what you did, that, you know, we as fans might be like, well, who the hell knows if Andrew Booth or Caleb Evans or Lewis Cine are going to be any good. But he made a specific reference to the work that they've done and how they consider these guys. He like rattled off all 10 and then came back to the 2 that he forgot because he didn't want to forget the shout out that, you know, in the room there or in the building in Egan, they really believe that, you know, you don't forget about the guys we've already drafted. And I know that that's coach speak and general manager speak to an extent, but I think a lot of us are walking on eggshells about Andrew Booth or Caleb Evans being the starter. Like, that's all you got. And I don't think that they're too anxietal about it. I think that they're kind of like, well, yeah, Booth can start. Why wouldn't he? When the rest of us are like, yeah, I don't know.
You know, but you're right. What general manager, what coach isn't going to say that? So trust me, I want to be optimistic. And hey, after seeing, what was it? A Caleb Evans Instagram video of him like freaking jumping goddamn, like 4 feet in the air. Yeah. Put him on the field, give him a shot. I don't care. But I just, please let me believe, you know.
Yeah. And Evans looked good when he was on the field and Booth did not. There was a difference there. So I think we can have a little bit more confidence that Evans is a real deal. And Booth, outside of like one training camp practice when he looked aggressive, it was really kind of a forgettable rookie season. But you alluded to the upcoming season, which, let's see, week 1 will be September. Is it 8th, 9th or something like that? Do you consider this season around the bend as all in for the Super Bowl once again, probably the 8th straight year, arguably since the start of 2016? Or do you expect this go around to be more of a transformational year to kind of get to the end of Kirk?
I just have a hard time believing that this season can be or is going to be an all-in for the Super Bowl. But like we just said, what coach or front office person is going to tell you differently? But our entire defense is once again being rebuilt. Like I said, I think half of last year's starters are no longer with the team, or at least it feels mm-hmm. that way as of today. We have an offense that can and should get points on the board, but this whole unknown factor of the defense is just like the one kind of thing that's like keeping me back from saying, yeah, there should be no problem. I mean, we made it to the playoffs with just a piss poor defense last year, but you know, we all know how that ended. I don't need to start crying, but I just think that 2024 is just more likely. I don't know. Brian Flores already just brings a completely different air and style to the team, which gives me hope. You know, when he had his opening presser and he was asked about the defensive scheme being like a 3-4 or a 4-3, and he responded with, well, it depends on the game. That who? Was like,
yeah, he said, who are we playing?
Yeah, that was all I needed to hear to like have that hope again. But with what personnel is mm-hmm. my big question. So I'd say 2024 is more likely, but that depends on the quarterback situation.
Yeah. The only reason that I think some folks have kind of just thrown in the towel on 2023 is because it really symbolizes the end of Kirk. And as you know, if throughout your political affiliation of the Church of Kirk, you know, there's a lot of people that are ready. They're chomping at the bit to get to the next guy. So I think that some of the camp has kind of said like, oh yeah, they're going to go 8-9 and then we'll move on to the next guy. And nobody knows who that is right now, but we shall see. I got two more quick hitters for you. And this first question is twofold. Do you have an appetite for Hendon Hooker in round one? Do you have an appetite for Hendon Hooker in round three?
Yeah, no, yes.
Same here.
I love Hendon Hooker, period. Mm-hmm. I love this guy. I love his style. I love his story, like his personality. And, you know, thanks to our buddy Tennessee, like I actually mm-hmm. watched him play last year and he genuinely looked like he could make these big throws, but first round, no, like I'm not loving it. You know, I saw Ian Rappaport literally just posted today, like he is still slated to go in the first round at this point, which I just find so odd. He was slated to go in the second before the ACL injury mm-hmm. and, you know, this skyrocket of his draft stock. I get it, but I don't. It just, you know, this is what happens all the time right before the draft, especially with quarterbacks. You know, we've seen it. We've seen it go both ways for sure. But I'm kind of concerned that I'm going to have like Kellen Mond like fear naturally instilled in me if this does play out. But, you know, third round, no problem. First round, I'm not going to be pleased.
Yeah, that's the difference. If a guy doesn't work out from round three, like Mond or like Hooker would be, nobody gives a shit. If the guy is drafted out of round one, you're considered incompetent. It's a waste. And it's all just whatever. And at least in these parts or in these realms right now, it's whatever your draft resume says. If you have the R1 attached to you, you better be good. And if it's R3, it's really just a lottery ticket. So I'm exactly there with you. I cannot, for the life of me, and I've tried to be ultra reasonable about this, I cannot get on board with the Vikings being the one team. It feels like a very Viking thing to do. Like, all right, we're going to be done with the guy we know throws 4,000 yards and 30 touchdowns, and we're going to go get an old ass rookie who has a bum knee. It just is like, really? This is what the big solution is? If we're going to do this, be really cool and get the 21-year-old, you know, who can run fast and who can throw at the football stadium. I don't want a half-assed solution. And if it comes out of round three, great. That, I mean, the stakes, it doesn't feel as gruesome. So I'm right there with you on Hooker. And again, I'm not kidding. If it's out basically outside of round one, I'll be like, cool. That's where he should have gone. But I don't understand how he could. It was like Malik Willis last year. And it's easy to say right now, well, Malik Willis sucked. Of course he went in round three. Last year, you watching the show right now, you thought Malik Willis was good and you believed he was going to be dragged into the top 10 and probably get picked 6 by the Panthers. We have history as a hindsight now. It's like, well, that guy sucked. Of course he didn't go in round one, but nobody knew it last year. So I see parallels between whether some of these guys that are getting dragged into round one, and Hooker feels like a keynote example.
I agree. And I know it's that big, you know, fifth year option, you know, is a key part of that, the whole mm-hmm. rookie deal, especially if you are getting a quarterback, you want to drag out that big money as long as possible with that rookie contract. I don't foresee the Vikings being in that unique position where like a fifth year option is really even like a deal breaker at this point. Like, we're just so far removed from that. And I think our fan base is the perfect, I love our fan base as much as I drive myself and everybody else drives me crazy. I just like every fan base, the grass is not greener, always greener on the other side. And everybody who's chomping on the bit for Kirk to leave and get this new guy, you know, we've seen this so many time and time again. It's, you know, we got to do it right. And I don't know if this team has ever done it right when it comes to the quarterback. Not since
Tarkenton.
No.
Not in the draft anyhow.
Not in the draft.
The last thing I have, let's say Anthony Richardson falls to number 10. In order to get in front of the Titans, would you advocate the Vikings trading two firsts and a third to go get Richardson?
No. I want to say no. Like, my gut just says no, because I love defense. Like, mm-hmm. all my jerseys are defensive players. And I feel like that's our biggest priority right now. I don't know how I'm going to feel like in the moment. Like, my gut tells me no, I will be so upset because we have no draft capital mm-hmm. and so many other holes to fill. But maybe that's me loving on Kirk too much. Maybe I'm looking at one side of this green grass and being like, no, I don't want the other.
Mm-hmm.
But that just seems like a lot to give up in a year where we don't have a lot to give.
Yep. Only 5 picks, a quarterback under contract through next year. And I guess I think the long game summary, and you'll know this because of your love for the draft, it doesn't really matter when we sit on these podcasts or you're talking with your buddies, like, oh, I want the Vikings to just get a quarterback in the first round. That's not the way their war room operates. They've identified the guys that they love. And if they say, hey, Levis is there at 17, we're going to trade up in front of the Bucks to get him, then that's will be what happened. They won't be like, you know, oh, Tanner McKee, let's go get him. He's a quarterback. They got the guys that they adore and love, and they've already decided what they're willing to give up to get them. So I caution people to say that are like, oh yeah, just go get a quarterback and then we'll groom him for life after Kirk. It's a lot more intense process where, you know, you find the guys that you know you can groom and develop because of all the interviews and stuff that you've done.
We're all just right. A bunch of talking heads compared to you know, what goes on in the war room. And that goes for anybody, mm-hmm. podcast, you know, even to the point of like some of the Ian Rappaports of the world, you don't know what's going on in that draft room, in their war room. At this point, it's all speculation, you know, in Quasi we trust, and we kind of have to go from there. But, you know, whatever happens. I'm not paid the big bucks to make those decisions. God, I wish I was, but, you know, maybe not. Maybe that's just too much pressure. But, you know, whatever happens, it's always a fun time. It's suspenseful in this really like hopeful, optimistic way. For me, it's Christmas. Like, yeah. This is my second Christmas of the year. And I don't know, I'm just ready to sit back, get on my apps. I still make an Excel spread. I'm so old school. I still make an Excel spreadsheet of like every draft for the last, I don't even know how many years. And what do I do with those? Basically nothing. I'm just a nerd.
Yeah.
But that's just like, that's how I celebrate the draft.
That is glorious. I wouldn't say that you're a nerd. I would say that is fantastic. Well, here's what I want you to do. I want you to check your calendar, and perhaps the Friday night. I don't know what your plans are, or the Saturday after the draft. But that way we'll have one or two picks to decompress, and we can kind of chat about who they got, and you could tell me your knee-jerk reaction. So check that out for us. If it doesn't work that weekend, we can do it the weekend after. But I think we have a golden opportunity to to talk again, right in the thick of it. Cause if it's Friday night, we'll be through round three. And by that time, they better have a handful of dudes. Does that sound decent to you?
That sounds perfect. I will have raw emotion and adrenaline going. It will be unfiltered. It will be glorious and maybe a little scary.
And you can have your glass of wine too. That's the perk.
Thank you. Yeah. Necessary these days.
So. Yeah, especially during a draft. All right. Well, we will talk to you then in about 15 days, if that's cool.
Sounds perfect. Thanks again for having me.
Oh yeah. Thank you for coming on, and we'll talk to you then.
Thanks.
Later.